Hi guys, it's Michael, G0PAT here. The internet, Twitter, discussion forums have been full of talk of the new QRP transceiver from Hans Summers at QRP Labs. And I was lucky enough to get an early order in, and I've just received serial number 420. So this is a little 5-watt CW transceiver, costs just $49. So for UK buyers with shipping, we're looking about £43 at current rates in late 2017. Took about 5 days to arrive here from Japan once the order was shipped, and this came direct to me, not via customs, so no duty or VAT, which was rather nice. Your mileage may of course vary. So I'm going to get this unboxed, and then we can have a look at what comes in the kit and we can start building. The kit arrives as quite a small package, and the manual can be downloaded from the QRP Labs website, where you can also find links to frequently asked questions and modifications. There's also a QRP Labs discussion forum on groups.io. Check it out if you have any problems during your build or setup. The kit contains everything you need to complete a single band QRP CW transceiver, and you can opt to build it all on the PCB or install your kit into your own enclosure. The transceiver also has built-in alignment and test tools and operating tools like a built-in Kia and Whisper beacon. There are just two surface mount components which come pre-installed, everything else is traditional through-hole component. The transceiver software comes preloaded on the microprocessor, and at this time the kits are shipping with version 1B. Your band choice is made at the time of ordering, and the kit supports 80, 60, 40, 30, 20 or 17 meters. The transceiver has a rather swanky 2-line 16 character backlit display, which can be configured to display a number of different things once of course your radio is working. There are 8 ICs in the kit, including the main processor, but only the processor uses an IC socket, and this helps to keep the costs of the kit low. You'll note in my build, I opted to add sockets for all of my ICs in case I blew one. Okay, let's get on with the build. First, I did a quick inventory check of all the components against the list in the manual to check everything was present. Next, I installed the microprocessor IC socket and the extra sockets that I bought for the other chips. Initially, I soldered two pins diagonally opposite to each other and then checked the IC or socket is seated correctly before soldering the rest. The capacitors are quick and easy to add, and the manual very helpfully includes the actual value printed on the capacitor to help identify them. I add a few at a time, bend the legs out at 45 degrees to hold them in place, and then solder them and trim the leads with small side cutters. Here I've added the diodes and crystals. It's worth being a bit sparing with the heat when fitting these devices, as they can be damaged by excess heat while soldering. All of the resistors are installed upright, and to speed up assembly and to make the finished radio look good, I've bent the leads on all my resistors in a uniform way so they look smart. I then follow the same approach to inserting and soldering them as I did with the capacitors. As it's easy to get things right the first time, I check the value of all my resistors, capacitors and inductors, not just visually but by also measuring them before checking their position, inserting them in the PCB and then ticking them off on the drawing. After installing the fixed and variable capacitors, the manual has you install the inductors, electrolytic capacitors, trimmer capacitor, transistors and voltage regulator, and the header pins, which are used as test points and to connect the display. Next, you have to wind 5 toroids. Toroids seem to be like Marmite. You either love them or you hate them. Personally, I don't mind winding toroids, but they can make your fingers a bit sore. A few tips for winding toroids. Check the position of the holes on the PCB for mounting your toroid before you start winding them, and then think about which direction to wind to get the tails hanging on the right sides. It's not a disaster if you get this wrong, but your inductors won't sit squarely on the PCB as expected if you wind the wrong way. Hot glue can be your friend. I use it to hold my toroids firmly in place, especially if I wind them the wrong way. As you wind the turns, be careful not to kink the wire and check that you haven't overlapped any turns as you go. Some enamel coated wire cleans simply by running a blob of solder up and down it, whereas other types require a bit more effort. I typically burn off the insulation with a lighter and then clean up with a little piece of emery paper. It can be a good idea to tin the tails before inserting them into the PCB. T1 is the trickiest toroid to wind in this kit, but Hans gives good instructions for doing this one. Note that if you follow the guidelines when you count the turns, they can initially seem off as they don't necessarily group as expected. Here we have a 20 meter version of T1, which actually looks like groups of 29, 3, 3 and 4, but becomes 30, 3, 3 and 3 when the tails are separated. I use a peak LCR meter to check all of my components, but particularly the hand wound inductors. Sometimes it's necessary to spread or compress the windings, or even add or remove a turn to bring the toroid to the correct value of inductance. Dry joints on a toroid are a fairly high probability if you don't clean off the insulation well. Once the toroid is soldered in place, I use a multimeter to check the connectivity across my toroid. Note that I'm touching the probes to the solder on the PCB, not the wire tails on the toroid. Once I'm happy there is conductivity, only then do I trim the tails. Initially I made a mistake on T1 and had to remove it and start again. The holes are particularly tough to clear of solder, so if you do make a mistake, use a reasonable amount of heat for a short time, desoldering braid, and add a bit of fresh solder into the mix to start the wicking process. Okay, that's all of the main components now, with just the display, input-output sockets and controls left to do. The pins from the 16-way header socket only just reach flush with the top of the PCB, however with a little heat, the solder flows down through the hole effectively. The board is designed to hold everything, however if you mount all of the connectors and controls to the PCB, you'll immediately spot how hard it is to fit the radio into a case. The display is at a different height to the controls, which are not aligned either. If it's just going to sit in your shack, then this might work perfectly for you, but I knew I'd want to take mine portable, so I've left the encoder, volume potentiometer, headphone and paddle sockets, power socket and control buttons off the PCB, and have replaced the 3.5mm stereo sockets and buttons with chassis mounted versions, and fitted a standard 2.1mm DC power socket. To enable me to test and align the radio, and to give me the opportunity to road test a chassis layout, I've just used PCB board to build a framework of an actual chassis to mount everything to. First time attaching the battery, it's almost 100% certain the display will either be too dim or too bright. Before you do anything else, adjust R47 so that you can read the display. The manual walks you through adjusting C1 for the bandpass filter and R27, R24 and R17, which fine-tune the IQ balance, low audio phase shift and the high audio phase shift respectively. Note that this display works in conjunction with the number displayed in the top right corner, so as I adjust the control, the display initially shows 7 with the bar quite low. It grows to almost full scale, then drops, but now you'll see we're on 8. In this way, a small scale can give quite accurate readings. With the bandpass filter peaked using C1, adjust R27, R24 and R17 in turn, looking for dips or nulls. At first the nulls may not seem super obvious, but I found that cycling through this process 2 or 3 times, you start to get more obvious nulls. On first sending, I found the side tone to be quite raspy. Turning the volume down to 40-50% made a huge difference. The transceiver can be configured to decode either sending, receiving, neither, or both. A quick experiment with my QCX revealed the following power outputs and current draw for a 9V, 12V, 13.8V and 15V supply. The radio is expected to generate about 5 watts at 15 volts, so I seem a little low on output power, but I'm guessing some tweaking of the low pass filter toroid windings may impact that. The receive filtering seems perfectly adequate for normal operating, and once the menu system has been explored, the QCX really is very simple to use. In summary, I found the transceiver reasonably easy to build, with only the multi-winding toroid T1 presenting a bit of a challenge. I know some builders have experienced issues getting their radios working, but mine was fairly smooth sailing and my only head-scratching moments were due to me not reading the manual properly. At its current price, this fully featured single-band QRP CW transceiver kit would seem to be an absolute bargain, which probably explains the initial high volumes of orders. My congratulations go to Hans for creating such an excellent little kit, and I look forward to seeing how others adapt and modify their kits and how it develops over time.